Good afternoon, everyone. This is John Farmer. Since September 1st of last year, I have served as the director of the Eagleton Institute of Politics here at Rutgers University. I want to welcome you today to the celebration of the extraordinary life of my predecessor, Ruth Mandel. There was simply no way to accommodate everyone who could possibly speak today, because Ruth reached so many people over the quarter century as director and her 40 years of involvement at Eagleton. But we will be using the chat box on WebEx as a virtual guest book. It's set to private, but we will be sharing it with Ruth's family after today's event. So feel free to record your memories and tributes there. I also want to note that there will be two short musical and photo interludes, and a surprise, some even say notorious message that doesn't appear in your program at the conclusion of today's program, so please stay tuned. By all rights, we should be celebrating Ruth's life together in person at Woodlawn, in the front hall, the drawing room, the library, the dining room under the gaze of Eleanor Roosevelt, in the warm and welcoming environment that Ruth did so much to create and that will always embody her spirit. Someday we will. But celebrating Ruth's life, however remotely, is particularly important today when our memories of her are so vivid. And although Ruth died of cancer and not of the pandemic, and the value of individual lives threatens to be lost in the daily tallies of fatalities to which we are subjected. Ruth, after all, was born into a world in which individual lives, particularly Jewish lives, were devalued, treated as disposable, when epidemics of typhus and other diseases were allowed to rage untreated in the death camps. Deaths in the millions in those days went unobserved, as too many deaths are today. The odds were long in such an environment that Ruth would even survive, particularly when the ship she and her parents took to escape, the St. Louis, was turned away upon reaching America. If her family had gone to Belgium or the Netherlands rather than to England, they would in all likelihood have perished in the Holocaust, as so many other passengers aboard the St. Louis did. So Ruth viewed her survival as luck and her life as a gift, and she shared that gift freely with people whose lives touched hers, many of whom you will hear from this afternoon. And the causes to which she devoted her career, expansion of women's youth participation in politics, the improvement of our form of democracy, and respect for diversity of viewpoints, have been in every respect an antidote to the devaluing of individual lives wrought by authoritarian governments or by natural forces like pandemics. For Ruth Mandel, every day she lived, every life she touched, everyone she loved mattered. She valued people, individual lives, in a way you simply couldn't fake. In the best tradition of the Jewish mother, she cared deeply. So it's fitting that the first voice we'll hear today is that of her daughter, Maud. In addition to being Ruth's pride and joy, Maud is the president of Williams College in Massachusetts and the author of a brilliant study of the lives of Muslims and Jews in France, which is very valuable to me when I was doing community work over in France. So I turn it over to Maud Mandel.
Thank you so much, John. I hope you can hear me. Can you nod or put a thumb up if you can hear this? Great, thank you. So let me begin first by offering my profound gratitude to you, John, and to Eagleton for organizing this tribute. And thanks to all of you, the many out there who have joined us today. My mother would have been touched, but also deeply embarrassed by what she would have called the fuss. She would have been surprised by how many of you are here. For a woman who spent a lifetime speaking publicly and making a name for herself, she was actually quite reserved and even shy. She hid it well, I know. I doubt most of you who knew her would have described her as timid or inhibited, but there you have it. It was part of her magic that she fought through those attributes to become the woman she was to all of you. When sorting last week through some of the papers and belongings my mother left behind, I found a folder of poems that she had kept that meant something to her. Here is one from John Updike called Perfection Wasted. And another regrettable thing about death is the ceasing of your own brand of magic, which took a whole life to develop and market. The quips, the witticisms, the slant, adjusted to a few, those loved ones nearest the lip of the stage, their soft faces blanched in the footlight low, their laughter close to tears, their tears confused with the diamond earrings, their warm pooled breath in and out with your heartbeat, their response and your performance twinned. The jokes over the phone, the memories packed in the rapid access file, the whole act. Who will do it again? That's it, no one. Imitators and descendants aren't the same. My mother was the whole act. Her brand of magic was so distinctively hers that I hesitate even to describe it here for fear of failing to do her justice. As one friend described my mother in a condolence note, she was sui generis, one of a kind. What made her so? She was smart, fierce, loyal, meticulous, demanding, judgmental, funny, absurdly late to everything, fastidious, articulate, tenacious, generous, verbose, analytic. This complex blend of adjectives added up to the powerhouse of a person, one able to move mountains when need be, build institutions, win over adversaries, or when necessary, push them aside, and fight the good fight. So many of you are here because of the ways in which she channeled all of that Ruth energy into her work to increase participatory democracy and celebrate and build upon what is best about the United States. Not many people leave this earth having made a mark, but Ruth B. Mandel, daughter of refugees, born in an inglorious moment when her very existence was challenged by the political structures into which she was born, did so. And somehow, while she was busy doing all these things, she was also brilliantly becoming a mother of the ages. At least at first blush, the setup was not what Dr. Spock and others might have laid out as the textbook for stellar motherhood. As a working divorced woman with an expansive career, my mother had little time for arts and crafts or board games or just hanging out. Rather, she parented me by folding me into her world. I tagged along to meetings. Her friends and colleagues were my extended family. I sat around the Center for the American Woman in Politics on days off from school, schlepped to conferences, and listened to stories of women legislators, the Equal Rights Amendment, and Rutgers administrative challenges. Is it any wonder I grew up to be a college president? But perhaps that's a story for another day. My mother talked to me about things that were far beyond my comprehension, and she did so without dumbing it down. Moreover, having invested her career in giving women a voice, she did the same for me, listening to every childish word I said as if it was interesting and worthy of consideration. In talking to me and listening to me in this way, she gave me a voice and the confidence to use it. I can think of no greater gift from a mother to a daughter. And what she did for me at the local level, she did for so many others at the national level. This too was a gift, and I'm grateful to her and the women of her generation for fighting this fight for me, for my daughter, and the women who will follow. Since she has died, many of you have written to share your loving condolences, and no small number of you have told me how much she loved me, how proud she was, and how she never missed an opportunity to demonstrate that love by sharing stories of my exploits and successes with anyone who would listen. But perhaps what you don't know is how I could say the same about you. My mother gave her heart and soul to the Eagleton Institute of Politics, to the Center for the American Woman in Politics, to the Holocaust Memorial Museum, and to Rutgers. Because of the way she loved you and New Jersey and this fine institution, this means you are all as alive to me as I was to you. She was proud of you, she loved you, and her love shone through in the many, many stories of your exploits and your successes. Her brand of magic mixed fierce loyalty and love, and she devoted her entire professional career and much of her heart to the people who have organized this event. Thank you. Thank you for the shape and meaning you gave to her life and for recognizing her today.
Thank you so much, Maude. Our next speaker is Governor Christine Todd Whitman. Governor Whitman is the first and to date the only woman elected governor of New Jersey. And she governed in a, I would say, much more bipartisan time than now. I would say as one indication of that, she hired me and promoted me, who is an unaffiliated voter, and trusted me with many important tasks during her administration. I would say that her governorship sort of embodied the spirit of Eagleton in that sense. She has become, since then, a frequent speaker in Ruth's classes and in other programs at Eagleton for fellows and undergraduate associates alike, Governor Whitman.
Thank you, John. And it's hard to go after Maud. That was a beautiful tribute to your mother and so appropriate that the rest of us are going to be hard pressed to find the words to capture exactly what your mother meant to all of us. I was thinking about that and trying to come up with what would be two or three of the most important words to me. And principled, committed, and passionate are the three, if I were to pick them out of all the others, that I would say Ruth Mandel embodied every day. She was passionate about this country and the promise of this country. She was passionate about our founding principles. And she understood that in order for us to live up to those principles, it would take everyone. Men and women, it would take people from all races, all stripes and colors, and she was committed to ensuring that they got the help they needed to be able to do that. Her particular path was women, her focus was women, but it encompassed everyone. And certainly I was lucky enough when I ran for governor to have what she had done in creating the Center for American Women in Politics, or what she'd done through Eagleton, to have the kind of support of women that I was able to get. She was a moving force. She was someone you didn't mess around with, one might say, but she was a great friend. She was compassionate. She was passionate. She was committed, and she was loyal to her friends and loyal to the principles of Eagleton and of in giving women particularly more opportunity to develop themselves and to understand that they could be anything they wanted to be, and there was a need for them in public office. And I think that was a particular beauty of what she brought, is an understanding that it's not an embarrassment, but it was a need. The country needs to have everyone from all walks of life participating, but particularly women. I think everyone on this call has lost a friend. I know that in the loss of Ruth, but everyone has lost an advocate throughout New Jersey and throughout the country. She was unique, and it's hard to top that. Thank you, John.
Thank you so much, Governor. A few years ago at Eagleton, when former Secretary and Senator Hillary Clinton, I was invited to speak, it turned into one of the biggest events in Eagleton's and Rutgers history, requiring relocation of the address to the Athletic Center. Secretary Clinton was always generous in welcoming Ruth's students, helping to inspire future generations of women and other leaders. And so our next speaker I want to welcome is Secretary Hillary Rodham Clinton.
Hello, everyone. I am so honored to add my voice to the chorus of those paying tribute to our friend, Ruth Mandel. From the moment I first met Ruth, back when I was First Lady of Arkansas all those years ago, I knew she was a kindred spirit. And I so enjoyed the times that we spent together. Whether she was bringing students to meet with me at the State Department when I was Secretary of State, or the two of us were delving deep into the data in the latest Center for American Women and Politics report. And of course, I'll never forget joining Ruth and, about 9,000 of her closest friends at Rutgers after the 2016 election. Our conversation that day covered everything from Ruth's experiences as a refugee fleeing Nazi Germany to the importance of fighting apathy and cynicism to her hope that we would elect a woman president before she was too old to dance at the inauguration. You know, her passion for inspiring the next generation of students and making sure that they understood the history and power of women's leadership was contagious. And like every other woman in politics, I owe a profound debt of gratitude to Ruth for her advocacy and support. She literally wrote the book, the first book, in fact, on women running for office. And of course, she not only co-founded the Center for American Women and Politics, she grew it into the premier resource in the country on that subject. From her perch at Eagleton, she validated all of our efforts She researched our campaigns and she drew lessons that are still helping to blaze a path forward for others to follow. I will miss Ruth dearly. She will certainly be on my mind when I cast my ballot this fall, and when our country finally elects a woman president, and make no mistake, we will one day, it will be thanks in no small part to Ruth and her tireless efforts. To Maud, Jeff, Barrett, and everyone else who knew and loved this extraordinary woman, you are in our thoughts, and Ruth will always, always be there as we think about how we make this country she loved the kind of place that includes, lifts up, empowers everyone. Thank you, Ruth.
One of Ruth's points of pride and continuity with her past was her service with the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum. In that connection, she valued very much her association and friendship with the museum's director, Sara Bloomfield, who joins us now. Director Bloomfield.
Thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Great. Thank you, John. I remember the museum's board chair affectionately and frequently calling Ruth, who was his vice chair, the process queen. Now, he was a resistance fighter against the Nazis. So for him, process meant moving slowly and accomplishing little. But Ruth was wise. She knew that process was about the wisdom and thoughtfulness that process generates when done well, and the integrity and accountability. Ruth called it governance, values-driven governance. And she was the leading voice in helping the museum transform itself from the anything goes wild, wild west approach of our early years to a mature institution. She was adamant about what it would take to run an effective institution and how right she was. Today, as I look back, it's clear that her early insights appear wiser and wiser with each passing year. She was also insistent on the importance of and precision in language. I can still remember her repeatedly asking during planning discussions about genocide prevention, questions like, well, exactly what does it mean to enhance the nation's moral discourse? What precisely is a national conscience? Ruth always challenged us, lovingly but firmly. Thanks to her, we continue to challenge ourselves and ask hard questions, a process that is vital for the health of the museum. Now, Ruth's life was not just full, it was packed, and yet her dedication to the museum knew no bounds. Every assignment was undertaken with exceptional rigor. She did nothing half-heartedly. Ruth thought about everything, and then she would rethink it, and she helped us become better thinkers. Ruth was the first person to suggest to me that I should consider becoming the director. I knew right away it was a bad idea for me and a bad idea for the museum. Well, guess what? I've been director for over 20 years, and it would not have happened without her encouragement, guidance, and inspiration. And I am just one among several women on the staff who have been mentored by Ruth. I remember the day when Ruth found on a list that the museum had discovered all the passengers that were on the St. Louis. She became very emotional when she saw her parents' signatures on the document. This happened well into her own mother's battle with dementia, and Ruth poignantly commented on how long it had been since she had even seen her mother's handwriting. The museum is now reaching millions every year. They don't know Ruth B. Mandel, but they are shaped by an institution that was shaped by her. And yet, in some way, they do know Ruth. For on display are photographs of a young couple and their infant daughter on the deck of a ship. We know, but they do not, that they will ultimately survive but that their families and two out of every three European Jews will not. Long after all of us are gone, those photos will continue to teach the important lessons of personal and political responsibility to which Ruth devoted her life and to which her numerous enduring achievements so powerfully attest. Thank you.
Thank you so much. As both Governor Whitman and Secretary Clinton mentioned, Ruth's co-founding nearly 50 years ago of the Center for the American Woman in Politics, known as CAWP, was a groundbreaking development in the struggle for greater representation of women in our political process and remains nationally prominent among Eagleton's many signature programs. Here to share her memories of Ruth is the co-founder with her of CAWP, Ida Schmertz. Ida.
Due to difficulties recording Ida Schmertz's remarks during the memorial, her words are read here by Ruth Mandel's longtime colleague and friend, Kathy Kleeman, who retired as senior communications officer in 2018 after 38 years of service to CAWP and Eagleton.
I was there at the beginning. During the hot summer of 1971, I was sitting in the Eagleton lobby waiting for an interview when in walks this young woman wearing a brightly colored gypsy skirt down to her ankles and covered with red, blue, yellow, green squares and large flowers, topped by an embroidered peasant blouse. This was the Ruth we all came to know and love, emerging from her hippie era. Those days were the height of the women's movement, lots of ferment. Don Hertzberg, the founding director of Eagleton, included in a large proposal to the Ford Foundation $50,000 over 2 years to start up a center to study the participation of women in politics, or the absence thereof. Don was a PR genius, but he was the only member of Eagleton who had any interest. The Eagleton faculty, of course, were all men, all political scientists and one presidential historian. There were no courses, books, study materials having to do with women and politics. As for the rest of the Rutgers faculty, forget it. As we got underway, we were faced with academics who said, "But there is no there, not a legitimate subject for study." Under that challenge, Ruth and I bonded for life. We were each extremely independent, strong characters, but melded into a perfect team. Ruth's ambition was as an academic with a doctorate in English, while I was more of an activist. There were no rules of the road. We were left alone to do pretty much what we wanted, and today you have the evidence that it worked. Ruth put herself in charge of education and research, which meant designing novel courses and research programs, which existed nowhere else, and recruiting faculty and researchers and gaining departmental approvals. Not an easy task, as you can imagine. But when Ruth sets an objective, nothing and no one can stand in the way. Ruth, of course, had never written a foundation proposal nor hired faculty, but there you are. I set up the public side of the center, gathering data, creating an information bank, and organizing meetings and conferences, all immediately successful and continuing strongly to this day. An interesting sidelight to our first conference for women state legislators was that no one, and I repeat, no one, who knew who the legislators were or where they were. So we got in touch with three strong national women's organizations in every state, asking them to give us the names and contact info for their women state legislators for a first national conference. We selected 50 from 26 states, bipartisan and very diverse. What seemed to us a straightforward conference agenda roused consternation among the women, who were leery of talking about their political lives in any detail, and certainly not a single one described herself as a feminist. We commissioned Jean J. Kirkpatrick, a recognized political scientist at Georgetown at the time, to turn the conference into a research project. She recruited a team to administer lengthy printed questionnaires and conduct three-hour interviews with each participant, which resulted in the first academic study of American women in politics, published as Political Woman. Prominent women journalists from leading publications had a field day. The New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, and many state and local press covered the story and put CAWP on the map. I cannot overemphasize the excitement and attention this conference generated. It changed people's lives and what they accomplished as legislators. By the time I left 3 years later, Ruth was recognized as the national expert on women and politics and was on her way to climbing ever greater heights over the years. It is an understatement to say we will miss her.
CAWP has been able to retain its leadership role nationally in no small part, not only to Ruth's efforts, but because of the efforts of its current director, Debbie Walsh, who will join us now. Debbie literally grew up at Eagleton and CAWP, and I won't say how many years that entails, but really she embodies the spirit of both Ruth Mandel, CAWP, and Eagleton probably better than anybody else. So Debbie.
Thank you so much, John. And Ida, thank you. These are the foremothers, and I'm honored to follow Ida, literally and figuratively. So I want to speak about Ruth, the institution builder, the pioneer of a field of study and of a movement that has worked to change the face of political power. I had the privilege and the joy of working with Ruth for almost 40 years, and the enormous responsibility of assuming the role of director of the center that she built and loved. It's easy to forget the world Ruth was operating in when COP began. Today, we have a woman Speaker of the House. We've seen a woman secure a major party nomination for president, and we're anticipating the third woman nominee for vice president. Women now hold nearly a quarter of the seats in Congress, and 29% of state legislative seats, and 9 women are serving as governor. And while I would say that these numbers are not nearly good enough, they reflect a reality that is a far cry from the one Ruth was navigating when she started working at COP. 1971, Shirley Chisholm had not yet run for president. Fewer than 5% of congressional or state legislative seats were held by women, and there wasn't a single woman governor. As Ida mentioned, Ruth often told the story of how political scientists would say to her, "After you count the handful of women who hold office, what will you do? There is no subject to study." Well, Ruth built the subject. She laid the foundation for decades of work in the field. She wrote the book on women running for office, literally and figuratively. She asked, "Who are these women? What motivates them? Who gets in their way? What makes them tick?" She made the world take the subject seriously. She fought hard to secure the support that allowed COP to grow and flourish. And no one taught her how. She had to figure it out as she went. She raised the funding that allowed COP to conduct groundbreaking research on women's routes to elective office and the impact that women have once they do get elected. And even though she wasn't a real political scientist, as we used to kid, she just played one on television, she was a major force in creating a field of study that is now respected in political science departments across the country. And Ruth always dreamed big. When women legislators sat in their respective state capitals in relative isolation from each other, Ruth had the idea to invite all of them to a national conference. At the time, there were about 900 of them. To say that there was skepticism about our ability to pull that off would be an understatement. But Ruth firmly believed that if we built it, it'd come. And she was right. She convinced major corporations and foundations to support the Forum for Women State Legislators. And in 1983, almost 1,000 women, both elected officials and leaders of the women's movement, gathered in San Diego for the largest meeting of elected women officials in history. Over the next decade, we would convene three more forums, and in the process, we created a community of elected women who no longer felt isolated and alone in their states. They shared not only their experiences of being women office holders, but they shared innovative policy initiatives, and collectively, they changed the public policy agenda in states across the country. Ruth helped make that happen. And then Ruth wanted to make a movie, a documentary about women in politics, reach a big audience with the stories of women office holders and candidates. Everybody who knew anything about filmmaking told us that that was crazy. So much money, so much risk, and that even if we managed to finish it, there was little likelihood that anyone would ever see it. But Ruth plowed ahead. She found a filmmaker, actually a former Eagleton fellow, and she raised some money and we started filming. You know, it felt a little like one of those old Judy Garland, Mickey Rooney movies. You know, the ones where they'll get a barn and they'll put on a show. And just like in the movies, when things looked bleak and the money was about to run out and the film might never see the light of day, Ruth figured out how to get the producers of Frontline at PBS. And lo and behold, we had a new partner in our filmmaking adventure. Judy Woodruff became our narrator, and Not One of the Boys aired the week before the November 1984 election with a viewership of over 6 million. Ruth pulled it off. Along the way, Ruth built a team of people who worked with her. She mentored them, empowered them, and allowed them to take leadership. Some were members of the staff, some were students. I was one of the many who benefited from being part of her team. Leadership transitions at organizations are notoriously difficult, particularly if the former director is still in the picture. But Ruth made sure I had the room to become the director. She gave me advice when I needed it. She liked to give advice. But she also gave me the space to go my own way, to try new things, and build on the legacy she left behind. I am eternally grateful to Ruth for the love and the support she gave me over the four decades I worked with her. She was more than a boss and a colleague. She was a mentor and one of my closest friends. She was family, and I love her very much. Ruth was there for me professionally and personally for every major event in my life, the wins and the losses, the heartbreaks and the joys. I am still struggling to fully wrap my head around what life without her is going to look like. And being in this moment of COVID makes it even harder. But she will live in my heart forever. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Debbie. As both Debbie and Ida mentioned before our break, one of the signature accomplishments of CAWP in its early days was to have this conference as the first forum for state women legislators. And our next speaker has been intimately involved with CAWP ever since then. The Honorable Mary Landrieu was elected to the Louisiana State Legislature when she's merely 24 years old, and she rose to represent Louisiana in the U.S. Senate. She's a longtime supporter of Ruth and of CAWP. She did attend the first forum for women state legislators. Senator Landrieu joins us now. Welcome.
Thank you, John, so much. It's a true honor to be on this call and video with so many of you, friends and family and admirers of Ruth. If I can get through my remarks with that song that's still in all of our hearts. But let me just say, particularly to hear the words of Secretary Clinton and Governor Whitmer and my good friend, Donna Brazile, who will be on later, and of course to hear Debbie and her memory and remarks of Ruth. I was at that first conference in, I think, 1983, as Debbie mentioned, along with hundreds, but not too many other women legislators who, having been elected in our own individual states, really felt untethered, not connected. I can't even describe the feeling, having now served for some years in the United States Senate, how it felt back in 1979, 1983. to be just one of three women in the legislature, to not have a Speaker of the House, a chairman of a committee, to not feel like you actually belonged. And Ruth Mandel was the one who said to all of us, yes, you belong. Yes, you should be here. Yes, your voice is important to be heard. She was our anchor. She was such a wise and resolute and strong and amazing woman. And hearing Maud speak about how maybe her natural instinct was to be maybe behind the scenes, to us, she was simply a hero. She was our, you know, harbor in the storm. She was a person we could talk to, we could call. We knew that she was there to support us and to validate, to most importantly, validate our own feelings about why we were in public office, to feel like we weren't just out of our minds, that the ambition or the passions that we felt, not for ourselves, but to serve others, to serve our families and our communities, was appropriate and was admirable and was right, because so many people in society were giving us the opposite signals. I don't really know where all that strength and wisdom came from, but I myself and hundreds and thousands of other women who have been elected or appointed to office really can thank Ruth for being the trailblazer that she was, being the resolute leader, speaking up for us, standing up for us, and encouraging us. And I guess we all, in so many ways, have so much to be appreciative for and to thank her for, and what an amazing legacy. And the final thing I want to just say is I've always admired how Ruth mentored Debbie. And I can remember how young we all were, and Debbie was particularly young. I wasn't much older, but Ruth just brought her under her wing and was so respectful of nurturing Debbie's leadership. And I think that Ruth knew back then how wonderful she would be as her own leader one day in her own right. And so that's such a testimony to all of us as we mentor younger women in our years that we have left. So Debbie, thank you for your leadership. John, thank you for the work that you've done at the Institute. And I can just tell you from, you know, my good friend Donna Brazile, who will speak in a few minutes, those young women that were at Ruth's side, I'm not sure we would have ever made our next election successful had it not been for Ruth telling us to go. You can do it. You belong here. Don't listen to what other people say. I believe in you. I know you can do it. So on behalf of myself, my family, and all the people I've been able to serve for these many years from the state of Louisiana to help them with their housing, with their levies, with their schools, with their health care, the tough votes I was able to take because Ruth gave me the courage to do that, I say thank you so much to all of you for your support and love of her, and we'll remember her for many, many years. And Maud, you're just such a testimony. You look so much like your mother. It's wonderful to see you, even though it's a video, and hope to stay in touch with all of you for many years to come. And please call me. And thanks so much to the Center for everything you've done for so many women in politics, in government, in our country, in the world. Thank you for helping us find our voice. Thank you, John.
Thank you, Senator. As the Senator mentioned, Donna Brazile also goes back many years with Ruth. Having met her, I believe, when Ms. Brazile served as Chief of Staff to Congresswoman Eleanor Holmes Norton back in the 1980s. She has spoken numerous times at Eagleton over the years and was one of the first holders of the Senator Winona Lippman Chair here at Eagleton. I want to welcome Donna Brazile.
I thank my good friend and my leader, Mary Landrieu. I had the opportunity of interning for Mary when I was just a teenager. In the Louisiana State Legislature. John, I met Ruth back in the 1980s when, of course, I was a member of the staff working for Jesse Jackson. And afterwards, Ruth, who was at that convention, that historic convention in 1984, I went on to work for the Mandel Ferraro campaign, and Ruth Mandel and I became lifelong friends. For over 35 years, she's been a guiding force in my own life, not only in politics, but also in academia. together with Debbie and Susan and so many of the wonderful staff there at CAWP, I have just been enamored with the type of transformational leadership that Ruth and others have provided to many of us, not only giving us the tools to teach the next generation, to encourage women to run for office. Ruth has just been a phenomenal voice for all of us, someone who has supported young women, who have mentored young women, but the fact that she has been so inclusive of women of color. One of the things that has always been important to Ruth and some people at the center was bringing in women of color, not only serving in the capacity of Winona Lippman, but encouraging New Jersey women, encouraging women across the board to find their seats at the table. And because she dared to make a difference, so many of us have stepped up to fill in that void, to bring in more people, to create new leaders out of the people that we have today. So I'm honored to be part of this tribute to a woman who did so much for so many. And I have to tell you on a personal note, every convention, Ruth would always seek me out, whether I was serving in the capacity of campaign manager or the last convention when I was chair of the Democratic Party. Ruth wanted her tickets. She didn't want one ticket. She wanted tickets for as many people that she could bring to the convention. And she wanted to see Hillary Clinton make history. I was so pleased that Ruth was able to get not only to the convention, but had good seats, as she once said to me, just get me a couple of good seats. And of course, if Ruth wanted good seats, I got good seats for her. But I have to tell you, Ruth was there for me when I didn't really know a lot about politics, being a Louisiana woman. I just wanted to be in the room with all those powerful voices, whether it was Belle Abzug, Gloria Steinem, Shirley Chisholm. Ruth always made sure that I got a seat in the room. And when I couldn't understand some of the politics, Ruth would always break it down and send me materials. But Maude, I want to say something to you. You probably don't know this, but during Hurricane Katrina, Ruth sent money home to Louisiana, not just for my family, but for so many families who were dislocated. And one such email she sent me, she said, make sure that you let everyone know that this is for in honor of Donna Brazile. It meant so much that she wanted to help so many, many people that she did not know, but she had a big, huge heart. When Debbie told me that Ruth was sick and later that Ruth passed on, I had to go back and read the Bible, the book of Ruth. And many of you know, this is a wonderful chapter in the Bible because Ruth was faithful. She was faithful to God. She had compassion. She was selfless. And it reminded me in reading that book that when we write this final chapter of Ruth Mandel, we will write about the huge sacrifice, the sacrifice that Ruth made and gave to so many others, the hope that she had in the future, the initiative that she always took, the persistence, and yes, her character. Finally, a few years ago, I went to the U.S. Holocaust Memorial. Ruth told me to go and be a part of a ceremony where you read the names of people who died in the Holocaust. I was there with a Holocaust survivor, and I probably got through about five or six names, and I just started breaking down. But Ruth encouraged me to continue. She was that kind of leader. She was one who not only lit the flame in us, but she kept it burning for others. So thank you. May her memory be a blessing. We'll continue to hold that light for others. Thank you for allowing me to participate.
Thank you. Thank you so much for those moving words, Donna. Susan Wilson has also been one of the greatest friends of Eagleton and supporters of CAWP through the years. She's also a founding director of the nonprofit group Answer, and I really welcome her this afternoon to be part of this ceremony. Susie.
Thank you, John. I'm deeply honored to have been asked to participate in this beautiful service where we honor this remarkable woman. What more can you say about a woman who has received these accolades and been called champion, believer, distinguished leader, national voice, founder, promoter, idealist, resource, cheerleader, conscience, source of encouragement, senior scholar, Board of Governors professor, public servant, director, leader, colleague, mentor, and friend. These powerful words are ones that I think we all probably have read on newspapers and heard on TV news since Ruth's death. I can speak most truthfully to the description of Ruth as friend. My friendship with Ruth was special in one way. It was two generations deep. It began with my mother, Catherine Kane Newberger, who served, as Debbie reminded me, on the original advisory board of CAWP. My mother always promoted women's suffrage and women's entrance into the political arena. I'm sure she did her best to help Ruth develop the foundation of the highly successful Center for American Women in Politics. My friendship with Ruth was a bit different. It came in the early 1980s when I came to Rutgers to pick up the reins of a program, ANSWER, which concerns sex education, and it was temporarily located in the School of Social Work. Ruth gave me guidance about how to find a permanent home for the program at the university. She gave me very, very good advice, and almost 40 years later, ANSWER remains to do its work and is part of the Graduate School of Applied and Professional Psychology. I wish my mother and I could have spoken with Ruth about many topics, including a phrase she spoke that is haunting. Ruth wondered out loud if recalling evil can make people good. She said she doubted it, but as an act of faith, we have to try. My mother, ever a realist who saw a lot of the negative sides of politics, probably would have agreed with Ruth's skepticism. I, an activist with a penchant for enthusiasm, would have taken the other side of the discussion had we had one. I would have said that of course we would have to try. And if we tried hard enough, we would succeed in changing people's hearts and minds. I intend to keep believing in Ruth's act of faith as an act of friendship. For the last few years, Ruth and I had a standing date for breakfast twice a year. We'd meet at the tavern room of the Nassau Inn at 8 o'clock in the morning, and Ruth really was on time for all of these meetings. And we would talk about, I really can't remember, we would just talk about many different things. We covered a wide range of topics and had a good time. I will miss these breakfast tête-à-têtes very much. When I found this bit of prose, or perhaps since I know Ruth Maud told us she liked poetry, we'll consider it a poem. I realized that these meetings don't have to end. Birth and death are only the door through which we go in and out. Birth and death are only the game of hide and seek. So smile with me and take my hand and wave goodbye. Tomorrow we shall meet again, or even before. We shall always be meeting again at the true source, always meeting again on the myriad paths of life.
Thank you so much, Susie. Ruth's essential right hand through the years has been Eagleton's Associate Director, John Weingart, who directs our educational programs and the Center on the American Governor. John joins us now, and I have to say that he's become a true trusted advisor to me and helped me through the many transitions that have occurred at the Institute since September. So, John.
Thank you, John. I first met Ruth in the same bar where Susie and Ruth apparently had breakfast, the tap room of the Nassau Inn in Princeton. That was the location she had chosen to talk with me about the position of associate director at Eagleton. Several months and meetings and interviews later, I was hired for what became a 20-year working relationship. I realize now that Ruth was then 62, an age that in the current context of coronavirus is considered old. Yet until just a year ago, when she became ill, Ruth was a vibrant leader, always open to ideas for new initiatives that might bring her beloved Eagleton Institute ever closer to being the hub of the known political universe. For most of the time I knew her, Ruth was planning to retire in 2 or 3 years. Not because she felt any diminution of professional enthusiasm or skills or enjoyment, but because she worried that staying too long could become, to use her word, unseemly. In the meantime, she enlisted several of us to let her know if we ever thought she was losing mental sharpness. But if anything, I think Ruth became more sure-footed and more productive in her 70s than she had been in her 60s. She also became more reluctant to delegate most decision-making or to be inattentive to any detail, from the order in which staff, faculty, and faculty associates should be listed on the website to the table arrangements and seating assignments for many of the meals held in the dining room. Ruth always wanted to know what was going on, whether that meant major political developments or good rumors or gossip. She apologized if she'd missed an email or not read all of its attachments. She tried to hear all the guests who came to speak, whether in the drawing room or in the fellows' sessions in Trenton. And she rarely missed Morning Joe, Rachel, Reporters Roundtable, or an issue of PolitiFact. She was extremely reluctant to ever postpone a meeting, dismissing my observation that people are rarely disappointed to have a slot suddenly open up on their calendar. Somehow, though, she accompanied that commitment through a prearranged schedule with the inability you've heard about, the inability to show up on time for virtually any event. Ruth also rarely encountered a tangent she didn't want to pursue. I would watch sometimes in awe and sometimes in horror as a passing comment would pull Ruth away from the purpose of a conversation or meeting to follow the long thread of a totally unrelated topic. I marveled that she always found her way back to the original subject. She never had to say, "Now, where was I?" Nevertheless, I found this pattern more often exasperating than charming. But I think it came from Ruth's love of good stories, both to tell them and to hear them. She was a caring listener, with deep curiosity and comfortably direct, almost confrontational lines of inquiry that helped her to form many meaningful and close and often lasting connections with guest speakers she met just once, as well as with her colleagues, and especially with the undergraduate and graduate students she loved getting to know each year while berating herself for not having spent more time with them. Ruth and I did not have identical styles, I think it's fair to say, but we were similar in important ways. When we met, both our mothers were living with dementia, we were both only children, and each of us had only one child of whom we were fiercely proud. And both of us liked to laugh. I know my recommending the movie Death at a Funeral and the Broadway play Old Hats were much appreciated, and to some extent may have helped me atone for sometimes suggesting that it might make sense for the Blaustein School of Public Policy and the Eagleton Institute of Politics to be a bit more closely aligned. Ruth wanted to ensure that Eagleton's accomplishments in teaching, research, and public service would continue to grow and become ever more widely recognized. She wanted us to have an impact on civic discourse in Trenton, in other state capitals, and in Washington, but also, as she would say, across town. It was very important to her that any present or future university president and other administrators always be aware of Eagleton as an extremely valuable Rutgers asset, but one that no one outside the building should ever even think of restructuring or modifying in any way. Ruth was easy to underestimate. She steered Eagleton through some difficult times to leave it as an important, dynamic place, a place that is perhaps as unique and often difficult to describe as she was. Her final accomplishment was to identify the perfect person to succeed her, to convince him to be open to the idea, and then to engineer a path that enabled him to gently take over, as if in academia it's common practice for everyone to choose their own successor. It was the final proof, if proof was needed, that her doctorate in English was not incompatible with subtle and sharp political skills. While it would have been wonderful if Ruth could have lived another decade or two, it was wonderful that she was able to embrace life so fully and often joyously for 80 years. In the end, and above all else, Ruth was a very kind person, and I know I will always miss her.
Thank you, John. We will now have a musical interlude, followed by our last group of speakers. And as I mentioned earlier, a notorious message that's not on the program. So I will be in touch after the music.
You dare to dream really do come true. Someday I'll wish upon a star and wake up where the clouds are far behind me, where troubles melt like lemon drops away above the chimney tops. That's where you somewhere over the rainbow, bluebirds fly. Birds fly over the rainbow. Why then, oh, why can't I?
Eagleton obviously takes great pride in its alumni, the former students who go out and make a difference in the world. Mo Butler, our next speaker, was an Eagleton Fellow in 1998 and is a regular guest lecturer in Eagleton's classes to this day and a partner in Mercury Public Affairs. Mo.
Thanks, John. Hallelujah. That was pretty, it's pretty amazing. It is an honor virtually be here with you all to celebrate someone who was near and dear to me. It's a mentor and a friend for over 20 years. When I think of Ruth, I think of a story. I'll be quick. I think I have 180 seconds. So it's January 19th, 2019. And I am in a car with Senator Booker, Congressman John Lewis, his chief of staff, and we are leaving the Atlanta airport for a 2.5 hour ride to Plains, Georgia. And we're heading to Plains, Georgia to participate in Bible study, President Jimmy Carter's Bible study. So for 2.5 hours, I'm listening to Senator Booker sort of pepper Congressman Lewis with question after question after question about the civil rights movement on Facebook Live. I was a little exhausted. We had been on the road for a long period of time. I wanted to stop, but it kept going. But it was fascinating. We get to President Carter's church, and he greets us, and we walk back into his study. And the warmth that President Carter and Congressman Lewis shared with each other, I'll never forget it. And then they started sort of talking about their past and shared history and started talking about the present. And then President Carter had to leave. He had to officiate his Bible study. So he did that, and he gave the most amazing 45-minute Bible study sermon with people from all over the world there. And then we got up and we left, and we hopped in a car to head back down to Atlanta for a 2.5-hour ride. And as we're driving back to Atlanta, it made me think about a fall day in 1998, 21 years prior. I was a recent graduate of Eagleton. I was in my first job out of grad school, which I was super excited to have, but you're always yearning to do more, especially at that age. And I got a call on a brisk fall evening in 1998 from Ruth. And she was just so excited. She had just, in her words, met the most electrifying, amazing young councilman from Newark. And she said that that she told him about me and said that we should connect. And she gave me his information. And it was Cory Booker, who had just won a council seat in 98. So I cold called Cory Booker, his office, invited him up to the place I was working at the time to give a commencement address to some young people. And it was a cosmic connection that was made between Cory and I. Fast forward a couple months later, I'm in Newark, I'm running a nonprofit. A couple years from there, he's running for mayor. In 2002, I was a volunteer, he loses. He comes back and runs in 2006, he wins. I become his chief of staff in City Hall. He runs for Senate. 7 years later, I become his chief of staff in the Senate. He runs for president. I'm a senior advisor on that campaign, travel all over the country. That's all due to Ruth picking up a phone one evening and calling me up and making a connection that changed the trajectory of my life. That's just one of many stories I can assume that many other graduates could tell about Ruth. I will deeply miss Ruth. I will forever love Ruth, and I will forever be paying the kindness she showed me forward. Hallelujah.
Thank you so much, Mo. Really, really appreciate that. One of the highlights of Ruth's weeks in the fall for the past decade has been sitting in on the seminar on political campaigning that has been co-taught by Maggie Moran and Mike Duhame. But both are Rutgers alums and experienced in political campaigning, Maggie for the Democrats and managing partner at Kevitt, and Mike for the Republicans as a partner at Mercury Public Affairs. And I think the reason Ruth took such delight in sitting in on that class is that it showed her and reinforced for her what politics could be, that it could be partisan and it could be aggressive, but it did not have to be uncivil. And I think she really took a lot of hope from watching the two of you interact in that seminar. So thank you so much. And I think Maggie's going to speak first. I think you flipped a coin or something. Maggie's going to speak first, and then Mike will jump in.
Thank you, John. Thank you all for being here today. It's a pretty extraordinary event. I knew Ruth Mandel since I was 18 years old, which means 27 years, I'm sort of shocked to say. She was a remarkable woman and led a remarkable life. Ruth lived every single day with intent, passion, and purpose. After all, she knew life was a gift, and she was hell-bent on making it matter in a very selfless way. Ruth's commitment to education, to justice, to equal rights, to voting education and participation, to women and people of color, to marginalized communities, was just unparalleled in what we know. So the beauty of Ruth Mandel, in my view, is what I call the Mandel Congress of Movement. She built her own Congress, her own symphony of thousands of us of diverse backgrounds and genders and orientations that have been trained and touched by her and the programs of the institutes in which she was involved. I think about the countless students that she educated and mentored and still served even as the director of the institute. I think about the legacy of the thousands of women and people of color who are taking their rightful place in public office, who have been trained and empowered to get out of their comfort zone and know that the causes they care about matter and that they can be the change they want to see. Her commitment to the equal airing of views, of respect and public discourse, that we can do this in a different way, and there's never been a more important time for that message than now. Her relentless dedication to Eagleton, to CAWP, to Douglas College, to Rutgers, but more important than anything, to the future, to our society. Ultimately, Ruth believed that our society could always do better, and she spent every waking moment, whether it's the way she raised Maude, who is clearly her own living legacy and was extraordinary today, to the impact she had on my life and countless others. I mean, it's really the most beautiful life you can live is in service of others. And that epitomizes Ruth. She dared us to dream, to believe in something more, to understand that just because we were told we had a place in the world and we had a lower expectation of what we were capable of wasn't acceptable, that we could do better, that we could be better individually and collectively. 11 years ago, Ruth invited Mike Duhaime, a Republican whom I didn't know well at the time, who I warred with publicly, to a meeting at her office to ask us to take over the New Jersey political campaigning course. Mike and I were in the middle of a 2009 nasty, negative, brutal election, both had small children, but was very intrigued by the idea because we loved Rutgers, we loved Eagleton, we loved Ruth, and we wanted to give back. But what's most interesting about the class to me is two items. The first is that Ruth knew something that Mike and I didn't at the time. She knew as soon as we walked into that room and started to teach in the way Mike and I could, that we would fall in love with our students, with the curriculum, with the empowerment of those students, with giving them a pathway forward. And it was so amazing to me that for almost 10 years, the director of the institute, who had more wisdom and knowledge, arguably, than Mike and I put together, sat in our class as a student to learn. And what's most compelling to me about that is what epitomizes Ruth. She was always growing. She was always learning. She was always giving and mentoring each and every one of us, and by extension, the others that we chose to mentor. Her insatiable curiosity and insatiable commitment to the causes she believed in was the essence of her life and drive to do better and to do more. And what we all need to do, the Mandel Congress of Movement, is to honor that faith she had in us, and to make it the essence of our lives, to rise and persist, to do better, and to be better, and to know that there is no limit to what we can achieve if we put our minds to it. One of the most indelible impacts that Ruth has had on my life, and there are many, because my entire trajectory changed the afternoon in 1992 when I saw Ruth on the lawn of Eagleton with a woman named Geraldine Ferraro, at which time I thought I was going to be a journalist. And that afternoon, I decided I didn't want to report the news. I wanted to be a part of making the news. But the other most indelible mark she gave me as a gift that's extraordinary is the love of teaching and the love of my Republican colleague, Mike Duhaime. We teach a class together that exemplifies exactly what Ruth would want, a public discourse that is fair and honest and candid, but not nasty, not abrasive, not personal. And we inspire young people to get involved in politics and public life, because it is an admirable profession if the right people and diverse people can take it back. So with that, I love you, Ruth, and I will miss you very much. And I turn it over to my good friend and loving friend, Mike Duhaime.
Thank you, Maggie. I appreciate that very much. Very inspiring. It's you're always inspiring, which is why I enjoy teaching the class so much with you, and really forever indebted to Ruth for what she was able to do by putting us together in that class. When I think about what it's like to be on this in this moment with so many amazing people on this testimony to Ruth. It's just I think about why people get into politics. And I think we all get into politics really to try to make our life and our communities a better place. And if you look at what Ruth's done, if you look at the testimony of all the people that have come before us, she's made so many lives immeasurably better. I hope she knew that at the time. She's made my life immeasurably better. And I don't think there could be any greater testament we could ever say to somebody than that they affected your life so much. And she really did. Like Mo and Maggie before me spoke about, there are moments in my life that I think back where Ruth really changed them. There was a moment in I took the class that I now teach with Maggie the first year that Ruth was the leader of the Eagleton Institute. I did not get an A in that class, unfortunately, but I did come on to teach it many years later. I hope General Farmer doesn't try to give everybody their tuition back for that now, who takes the class now. But that class changed my life. And seeing some people come in, I realized there was a way to participate actively and make that difference that I hoped for without actually being one whose name was on the ballot. And many young people don't know that. And the class and Eagleton itself has done that. A number of years later, I was the political director of the Republican National Committee, and Ruth asked me to come back and speak at Eagleton, which was just a wonderful treat to go back and stand in the front of the room where I was afraid to raise my hand 10 years prior and actually speak. And then a few years after that, she asked Maggie and I to teach that class together, and which has been an incredible moment in terms of how it's changed my life. It's led to that friendship with Maggie that she alluded to, but with so many others, and Debbie and John and so many others at Eagleton, Randy and Kelly, and so many of the people we teach with, and how great they've been, and all the guest speakers. And that's all because of Ruth, but most importantly, led to my friendship with her. Ruth was an incredible mentor, gave me confidence as a teacher, something I never thought I would be. And she gave me confidence that Maggie and I were a great team and we could do so well together. But I'd learned so much from her. And one of the things that I think she's been great about and has been complimented on so much today is what she did to empower women going through. But one thing that often gets left out is what I think that means to the men who watch. And I think what she has done is there are generations of men now growing for which it is not a big deal, as big a deal as it was in 1971. I came of age when Governor Whitman was governor, and I had a female congresswoman, and my mom was even the mayor of my town. And that's where we're going and where we're heading, and in no small part to Ruth Mandel, where this becomes more and more common. And the work that she led and that Debbie continues to do is amazing. But the most important thing she taught me is she led by example. When she disagreed, she did so in a way that was asking questions as opposed to in a condescending way. And I think that's something that she embodied and wants us to keep forward. She was humble. As Maggie said, she would often stand in the back of the class, and I would think she wanted to say something. We would ask, did she want to say? She said no. She would just come in. And if she raised her hand, it wasn't to give a comment. It was often to ask a question of us or of one of the speakers, which was great. She was constantly intellectually curious. She always asked questions of us and of our guest speakers, which was great. She was tough, and learning a toughness from her, watching her lobby Governor Christie for more funding for Eagleton when he came to speak was pretty fun to do. And she cared, and you knew that every time. She cared about me as a person. She cared about America. She cared about the students, and it was wonderful to see that. And if I can have a fraction of the impact on lives going forward that she had in mind, I'll consider that a success. She was a giant at Rutgers. She made Eagleton better. She made Rutgers better. She made New Jersey better. She made America better. She made my life better. So I appreciate the opportunity to be here with everyone. Thank you, John.
Thank you, Maggie and Mike. Really appreciate it. Our next speaker, Richard Roper, is someone I've known for decades. He's a member of the Rutgers Board of Governors and a visiting associate at Eagleton. Has given many hours of his time helping to shape Eagleton's incoming classes. I've served with him on the Advisory Committee on Judicial Conduct and on the Institute for Social Justice Board, and I'm now just delighted to be sharing time with him at Eagleton. And Richard joins us now.
I became familiar with the Eagleton Institute of Politics during Alan Rosenthal's tenure as its director. I was at the time director of the Program for New Jersey Affairs at Princeton's Woodrow Wilson School of Public and International Affairs, and often attended events at Eagleton. I was particularly impressed by Alan's work, focused on raising the profile of state legislatures all over the country. His contribution in this area led to the realization of the modern professionalized legislatures of today. I admired his applied scholarship and the wit and humor with which he approached his academic pursuits. When Alan retired as Eagleton's director, I thought it would be difficult, if not impossible, to find a replacement who combined the wit, intellectual depth, scholarly commitment to government, politics, and public service that he had brought to bear. Ruth Mandel, who was chosen his successor, quieted my concerns. She, like Alan, took on the challenge of shining a bright light on another unexplored and underdeveloped aspect of the body politic, the role of women and the promotion of gender equality in America. She applied the same level of intellectual rigor and public-oriented scholarship that had been shown by her predecessor. She brought a searing commitment to the advancement of women in the public square. I believe Ruth will be remembered as one of those courageous individuals who sought to make a difference in shaping the contours of political participation in our country. In terms of the significance of her contribution, she, in my view, stands with Winona Littman, the first Black woman to serve in the New Jersey Senate, Shirley Chisholm, the first Black woman to serve in Congress and the first woman to run for the U.S. presidency, and of course, Hillary Clinton, the first woman to be nominated by a major political party as its presidential nominee. Without doubt, Ruth Mandel helped lessen the difficulty women face when seeking elective office. And in so doing, she, like Alan Rosenthal, raised the national profile of the Eagleton Institute of Politics and that of Rutgers, the State University of New Jersey.
Thank you, Richard. And as anyone who teaches knows, our future is bright because of our students. Sophia Samuel is an Eagleton undergraduate associate from last year's class, the class of 2019, and was a student of Ruth, and I welcome her to deliver remarks now. Sophia.
Thank you, John, and thank you to all for joining us today to remember and celebrate the life of an inspiring woman. I met Dr. Mandel a little over 4 years ago as a young Rutgers undergraduate. To many professors, I was just a quiet student who gravitated to the corners of a class where few could see or hear me. But Dr. Mandel saw more in me than that immediate shyness. It was in her classroom where she taught me about fearless women like Shirley Chisholm and Eleanor Roosevelt, their powerful voices resounding through the Eagleton drawing room and encouraging me to grow my own. It was in her classroom where, with a cup of black coffee in hand, she impressed on me the value of civic engagement in a future where women leaders of all backgrounds were a norm and not an anomaly. I always found a great comfort and brilliance in Dr. Mandel's words and lessons. When they weren't delivered with a quick wit and easy humor, they were conveyed with the same forthrightness as when RBG declared she would only be satisfied when 9 women were on the Supreme Court. Her toughness pushed me to grow within and outside my comfort zone, and she supported me through every academic and professional success. Her advice was invaluable, and throughout my college career, she was a mentor, a friend, and a constant. I've spent many days in the company of Dr. Mandel, sitting at the wooden table in her office, discussing the state of politics, the fate of our nation, and the latest installment of The Rachel Maddow Show. Though I now find it difficult to remember the tiny details of every conversation, one central notion always hovered in the space between us. How could we shift the political power that had been too long in the hands of, as we would chuckle to ourselves privately, unremarkable men? Dr. Mandel's conviction her whole life was that women should lead, but she didn't just preach these words, she was a paragon of them. Though I wish she lived to see a woman president, and yes, we did have a particular woman in mind, the pioneering work she accomplished at CAWP and Eagleton has positioned us to be in a more auspicious place to realize it. And what humbler origins for a pioneer than being denied entry as a young Holocaust survivor to a country that she would eventually make a better one through her sustained efforts. While we all mourn and heal from the passing of a formidable woman, Dr. Mandel would want us to remember that there is so much work yet to be done. If we can acknowledge anything now, it's how easily and quickly decades of social, economic, and political advancement can be overturned. Whether the matter at hand is climate change, gun violence, voter suppression, immigration, or the ongoing brutality against Black Americans, there's crucial progress that still hangs in the balance. If she could part us with any wisdom right now, I think it would be this: a democracy that fails to reflect and heed the people both affected by its decisions and necessary to its survival is really no democracy at all. During these difficult times, I'm reminded of how important our teachers are. Their inspiring lessons manifest in our lives, and their recognition and belief in us, even when we doubt ourselves, illuminate a path to go confidently in the direction of our dreams. This was Dr. Mandel's impact on my life, and I hope I can cherish hers by doing my duty faithfully and being a bold, forward-thinking citizen of our democracy. As Dr. Mandel continually reminded us, onward, let us all honor her legacy by going resolutely and unapologetically onward. Thank you.
Thank you, Sophia. Karen Stubas is a vice president for academic administration at Rutgers, and she is speaking as a former dean and a former general counsel of the university. She is quite simply the go-to person for so many of us at Rutgers for advice and information on a whole wide range of issues affecting the university. More important for today's purposes, she's a very close and dear friend of Ruth Mandel. So welcome, Karen.
Thank you, John. Thanks to all of you for being here, and what a great way to spend a May afternoon being in Ruth's presence again. You've heard from the previous speakers so much about Ruth as a teacher, a scholar, a leader, an institution builder, a visionary, and so much more. Literally an awesome woman, a woman I was literally in awe of when I first met her, but it's my pleasure to tell you about that woman, not only as my colleague at Rutgers, but most of all as my very dear friend. My interactions with Ruth began when she was director at Eagleton and I was a member of the central administration at Rutgers, which I still serve. Academic administration being what it is, most of our conversations early on centered around budgets and how to get Eagleton more resources from the university. I say conversations, but in fact, Ruth and I were partners in crime in those days, and scheming might be a better description for what she and I were up to. So for Rutgers administrators who were listening, turn off the audio for now till I get through this part. I did have access to some modest pots of money at Rutgers in those early days, but Eagleton's budget in those days and up to the current time was itself so modest that great things were possible at relatively little cost. So Ruth and I would have multiple lunches and dinners trying to figure out how to approach the pots of money and get some of them for Eagleton. I'm happy to say that two of our earliest victories were creating the Center for Youth Political Participation under the leadership of the wonderful Elizabeth Matow, which is so important, particularly these days, and bringing civil rights icon John L. Lewis to Eagleton and to Rutgers, where he spoke to a standing room only crowd at Nicholas Music Center to talk about the graphic novel March, his graphic novel with two co-authors. He was greeted like a rock star. Because of Ruth's influence, I got a half hour with him alone in the green room, and it was and continues to be the thrill, one of the big thrills of my life. Of course, once I was in Ruth's orbit, I started to receive invitations to events, receptions, and dinners at Eagleton in the iconic Eagleton dining room, meeting incredible people, having fascinating conversations, great food. Wonderful students, fellows, and guests, and so forth. Totally fantastic, and always a highlight of whatever day that was. At one point, I was so in love and continue to be so in love with Eagleton, I stopped introducing myself with my university title and just said, I'm an Eagleton groupie, and let it go at that. In addition to budgets, another major topic of discussion between Ruth and myself over the years was the Eagleton leadership succession, which she and I were talking about as early as 2015. I remember specifically that it was 2015 because Ruth said she wanted to stay through the 2016 election because she expected it to be another Bush-Clinton matchup and thus be a historic event. 2016 turned out to be historic, but not quite in the ways that we thought. John, I have to tell you that even in 2015, Ruth and I were scheming about how to get you into the position. Referencing John Weingart's comments as well, Ruth seemed unaware that most people didn't choose their own successor, but Ruth was working on it early on, and we're very, very happy that she was successful. Was my political shrink and sounding board, looking every day for confirmation that things nationally were or were not as bad as they seemed. I am not proud to say that I continue to use Ruth shamelessly in this manner, even after back over my emails and text messages in preparation for this afternoon. I am relieved to say that she seemed to be a very willing and indeed enthusiastic participant in those conversations. And if Ruth were here today, we'd be discussing such things as Biden's best choice for vice president and Nancy Pelosi's face mask, obsessing me these days. I really cherish the fact that I visited her twice after she stopped coming to Rutgers and she got sick. The first was last September over the Labor Day weekend. I wasn't sure if she was up to having visitors or not, so I was thrilled when she said I could come. But Ruth being Ruth and in control and in charge at all times, I was given a very explicit set of instructions. Number one, I was told to bring my own food and drink because she was not going to provide any of that. I was told not to come if I had even a hint of the sniffles or was otherwise feeling unwell, which of course is the right thing to do. And number three, I was to be prepared for a quote, tiny bald Martian. That was Ruth's characterization of herself, because she was not going to be putting on a wig or any other head covering. And of course, Ruth being Ruth, I followed all of her instructions to the letter of the law. I pulled out a bottle of water from my bag and she said, I could have given you water. I said, well, you told me not to bring, you know, to bring all of my own stuff because you weren't going to be providing me anything and I obey you at all times. When I got to Ruth's house in Princeton, I found not a tiny Martian, but Ruth. Ruth was strong of voice. We sat in the kitchen. We talked for upwards of 3 hours. We talked about her treatments, about national politics, about Rutgers politics, of course, about the Eagleton succession, about her work, my work, Maud and her family, my family. Ruth was always a wonderful sounding board for things going on in my family. Oh, and at that first meeting in September, I met Bella the Wonder Dog. And that was a trip as well for anyone who knows Bella. I have to say the only time I felt that I wasn't being a totally good friend to Ruth was we were having lunch at Effie's in Brunswick on Easton Avenue. And she said with some excitement that she was getting a puppy. And I said, what, are you crazy? So I sort of dampened her enthusiasm a little bit. I'm a little bit sorry about that. But I finally did get to meet the inestimable Bella in September. And that visit to Ruth was absolutely the best part of my Labor Day weekend. The last time I saw dear Ruth was in January of this year, the Sunday of Martin Luther King Jr. weekend. Once again, Ruth was Ruth. She greeted me at the door, although we kept what we call today a social distance. The word had just been broken about Rutgers' next president, Jonathan Holloway. She had the Times out, the full spread, and we spent another 3 hours talking about the future of Rutgers, the national scene, Ruth's plans to write up the history of CAWP, all manner of things. And finally, Ruth gave me advice on where to find a good mother of the bride dress. Now, there's a whole nother Ruth story about Ruth's role as fairy godmother to my oldest daughter and being responsible for my daughter meeting the man she will marry in November, COVID-19 permitting. But that's for another time, and that's a whole different side of it. I didn't get to see Ruth after the January visit. She started to not do too well with the treatments after that time. But again, out of my need for her selfishly and out of a desire for Ruth to know that I was still there for her, I did continue to email her, and I'll give you just a little bit of a flavor of what our staccato emails have become. So, on February 4th, referencing the debacle that was the Iowa caucuses, I wrote to Ruth, "This is not a good way to begin." Ruth immediately replied, "A multifaceted disaster." On February 14th, I announced to Ruth, "I'm going to marry Chuck Rosenberg." Quick as a flash, Ruth wrote back, "No, he's mine." Now, for anyone who knows, if you don't know who Chuck Rosenberg is, please look him up. This is not as salacious as it sounds, although I think Chuck Rosenberg would be horrified to learn that Ruth and I were writing about him in this manner. Don't tell. Finally, on Super Tuesday, March 3rd, I whined to Ruth, "I miss Chris Matthews, he should be here." And again, immediately, Ruth wrote back, the reply was, "Me too, we're bleeding hearts." So that was in March, and that was my last communication with Ruth. The urge to email, text, or call Ruth still washes over me several times every day. I miss her very, very much. She's a dear friend. The depths of our friendship, I have just given you a tiny hint at. It was very deep, very long, and together we talked about many things important, sensitive, painful to us both. I miss her very, very much. There will never be anyone like her again. I thank you all for honoring her like this today. Thank you.
Thank you, Karen. I was frankly unaware that you were part of the conspiracy to recruit me into this position. I will say that in one of our conversations that Ruth and I had about this, and I was going through the various reasons that I didn't think that I was the right person. I she had answers for everything, but I said, you know, I've never run for office, and she said, neither have I. I've never really only participated in one political campaign. I've basically only given to two, to Christy Whitman and to Elizabeth Warren. And then I finally played my trump card and I said, and Ruth, I'm not a woman. And she smiled and she said, well, nobody's perfect. So we replayed the last scene from a movie called Some Like It Hot. I don't know if anyone remembers that movie, but it was a funny exchange. I think it's fitting at the close of this memorial that we hearken back to the beginning of Ruth's career. I'm sure that many of you are aware that Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg has recently been in the hospital with an infection and has a completely crowded court docket, so she's admirably keeping up with. But despite these complications, she took time to write the following remembrance of Ruth Mandel, which I will share with you now. "It was my good fortune to have known Ruth Mandel, both at Rutgers, where I was teaching when she began her affiliation with the Eagleton Institute, and in her years at the helm of the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum in D.C. Women in politics seemed a distant development when Ruth Mandel decided to spend her days studying this phenomenon. She traced the history of women's entry as insiders in government at local, state, and national levels. Her work encouraged women to take up the daunting challenge of participating as major players in our democracy. While she didn't disguise the difficulties, she emphasized the importance of women lending their intelligence, experience, and insight to ongoing efforts to create a more perfect union. Among second wave feminists determined to advance the well-being of girls and women, and thereby of the entire society, she ranked with the most devoted and the least self-regarding. For all the good that she has done, her life is cause for celebration. Ruth Bader Ginsburg, May 18th, 2020. On behalf of everyone at the Eagleton Institute and Rutgers University, I thank you all for attending today and participating, and I wish you all a good evening."